Welcome. Sorry, I was just going to run and lower the lighting a little bit to something slightly less bright. I'll do that in a minute. And apologies for the delay. We have been waiting for our audience to gather because we understand there is Doris is causing problems on the tube. So we might have some audience entering at the back. Anyway, so welcome to Fundamentals. This is a debate series chaired and convened by Ollie Wainwright, our guest, who you all, I'm sure, know as Guardian architecture critic and writer. My name is Mel Dodd. I'm the Programme Director of Spatial Practice here at Central St Martin's, and we are hosting this series. It's very much part of a set of research interests that we all have. A good part of the audience are students, and we also have external guests. So welcome to you who don't know us, and thanks for coming. It's been an incredibly popular series, and you might also be aware that it's videoed and filmed, so we release the films the day after, and they're up on our website, and that's a fantastic resource as well. And you might also know that Ollie has been releasing articles weekly that link to the themes of the debate. Also, if you haven't seen those, go and look for them, because they're the triumvirate of the event, the film, and the article is really amazing. Tonight is the final evening of the series, and I just wanted to say one thing, because when we get to the end of this evening, and Ollie, I'm going to pass to Ollie in a minute to introduce this evening, but when we get to the end, we're all desperate to run down to the bar, which is at the end of the building. So I know I won't be able to say this at the end, but I really want to say an incredibly large thank you to Ollie for such an amazing job. I mean, he's a natural. We're trying to work out a TV series as we speak. And we need to give him exactly some whooping and jeering. And yeah, I think particularly the students in the room would echo what I feel, which is that it's been really a privilege to have this many guests with this much knowledge, this well aligned to what we're interested in, and sort of convened and chaired by such an engaging person. So, Ollie. And we'll be taking Ollie out to dinner to say thank you another night. But really, thanks so much, Ollie. It's been amazing. Woo! So without further ado, I'm going to hand over to him, but just be aware that this is participatory. So at the end, you have an opportunity. There's roving mics. So gather your questions and we'll can carry on conversation at the bar afterwards. So thank you.
Well, what an introduction. Slightly alarmed now that I'm not going to be able to live up to that incredible description. But no, thank you all for coming. Thanks for braving Hurricane Doris and battling your way through the elements to be here. It's particularly timely, actually, that we're talking about landscape this week, because I went to interview Ken Shuttleworth of Make Architects. I don't know if you guys have seen what he's planning to inflict on Manchester, but these two gargantuan bronze skyscrapers that are going to stand opposite the town hall, paid for by Gary Neville and Ryan Giggs. So I went to interview him to kind of ask him about the architecture, you know, the design of these buildings, and all he wanted to talk about was landscape. Which I found fascinating. You know, you're designing the two tallest buildings right in the centre of Manchester, two biggest buildings that the country has seen in a long time outside London. And the first thing he said was, can I talk about my garden and the public space and the way I've designed these steps that are inspired by a street in Malta? And showed me these kind of incredible bucolic visions of green walls, you know, dripping with vines and people sitting out on these kind of pastoral terrace scenes. And it made me think either we've lost faith in the power of architecture or landscape has become such a powerful tool in our kind of collective imagination. You know, who could say no to a garden? What kind of mean-minded planning committee could turn down a new, you know, green vision, a new green heart for the centre of Manchester? And it's being used, you know, across London, every single major development, it kind of foregrounds its green public space, whether it's a sky garden, a new High Line for East London, a pocket park, a green ribbon, a linear green lung. All these things are getting more and more elaborate. In East London at the Bishopsgate Goods Yard, we've been promised a rich, multi-layered, three-dimensional landscape concept. Just so you don't see the seven towers of luxury flats that are kind of looming behind you. often these things don't quite turn out as promised. You know, what were going to be the rolling fields end up being small handkerchiefs of lawn. If that, you know, the landscape is often the first thing to be value engineered from a project. In Vauxhall Nine Elms, this kind of new paranoid high security enclave of £20 million penthouses, you know, forget about the buildings, we've got a linear park, a kilometre-long green lung that's going to breathe life as a sustainable green backbone, we're told. So that's kind of one aspect of what's happening. At the same time, so-called kind of well-intentioned green space projects often have a slightly unintended consequence, which has been termed eco-gentrification. So like New York's High Line, you know, which began essentially as a kind of bottom-up community-driven project, has had the effect of raising land values, pushing people out, small businesses are having to move, local residents are being forced out because the park itself has become so successful. It's the very reason Central Park was actually built in the first place, to raise land values around that area of Manhattan. So it's nothing new, and it's always been going on, green space used as a kind of way of rising land value. At the same time, we're seeing a kind of, relentless privatization of space that we already have. Public space is no longer public, but POPs, privately owned public space. I don't know if you guys saw when you came in tonight to Granary Square, there's a little sign saying, please enjoy this private estate considerately, even though the developer is claiming it's the new largest public space in Europe. Even when space isn't privately owned, it's often being privately managed through business improvement districts, as I'm sure we'll hear more about tonight, which effectively shift the maintenance and the kind of running of the public space into the private sector. And there's one project that, to me, kind of symbolizes the convergence of all of these trends, the Garden Bridge. £60 million of public funding, most of which has already been spent before the project has even started construction. As you all know, large groups are going to have to register in advance. You'll be tracked through your mobile phone signal. There'll be no playing of musical instruments, making speeches, or releasing balloons. And we could end up being saddled with a £3.5 million annual maintenance cost, even though this whole thing was going to be gifted by the private sector. So can there be another way? Is landscape always destined to be the kind of decoy, the garnish? As someone tweeted at me tonight, you can sprinkle parsley on a steak, but it doesn't make it a salad. I would say that's true of a lot of London's new parks. So I have gathered together five experts in the future of London's landscape and public space. I'm going to introduce them briefly now, and then I'll give them a proper introduction before they each give their presentation. We're going to kick off with Joanna Gibbons from Landscape Practice J&L Gibbons. Then we'll be having, in fact, sorry, I should have the next slide on the screen. Stephen Richards from Landscape Practice Gillespie's. Then Richard Reynolds, who describes himself as a guerrilla gardener. After Richard, we've got writer, journalist, and academic Anna Minton. And finally, Tim Waterman has heroically stepped in because one of our other speakers pulled out. Tim is a senior lecturer at the University of Greenwich. And I should also just say, if you want to be tweeting, to log on to the cloud, given that there's no phone reception in this building. So our first speaker is Jo Gibbons. She's a founding partner of J&L Gibbons, a landscape architecture practice that works on green infrastructure and urban regeneration at a strategic and local level. Their projects include Dalston's Eastern Curve Garden, a new park for the Alexandra Road Estate, and Croydon's new Ruskin Square. So over to Jo.
Good evening. Thank you very much, Ollie, for inviting me. And thanks for making it through Storm Doris. 5 minutes. I'm not going to talk about why you should be engaging a landscape architect early in the planning process. You'll be pleased to hear. I'm going to ask a few simple questions. And as Ollie asked us to do, set out our stall as directly as I can and look forward to answering questions. So if you had the choice, would you choose a place to live with or without a garden? Would you walk or cycle down a street with trees or without trees? And would you choose to walk through a park or stick to the road? We know the answers to these questions, and we don't need to be landscape architects, ecologists, botanists, or greenwashers. What we are dedicated to is promoting and protecting and designing with nature and in the urban landscape, an element that is so soft, so easy to ignore, so easy to undervalue, and therefore so easy to not include or value engineer away. It is the child in this debate. It is vulnerable, it's precious, and it's resilient but needing of constant attention and nurture. So apathy, in my view, is not an option. When we're talking about, in this instance, the quality of life, the bigger issues, of course, are to do with territory. The relationship we have with our land, the soil beneath our feet, and what is below that. The very notion of archaeology is to do with identity, surely. It's to do with all the things that you'll soon be enjoying in the Museum of London in their new location, which is a phenomenal load of 2,000 years plus of fabulous information on where we've come from and how we evolved in this city. It's to do with urban intensification, the fact that 70% of the world's population will be living in, it's estimated will be living within cities by 2050. It's to do with soil restoration. Soil is the foundation for all life, and yet soil degradation is alarming, and 10% of England's soil, for instance, rests within the city. It's about air quality. London breached its annual air pollution limits just 5 days into 2017, that's kind of a shameful reminder. It's the effects of climate change, rising temperatures and frequent storm events which cause surface water flooding. And if you consider that 80% of London's public space is streets and squares, in other words, impermeable, then that's a real issue and a challenge and an opportunity. And it's about mental health, mental well-being. Those living in the cities are statistically more vulnerable to psychosis. So we must define a new form of growth agenda. We must define something that is green, but also genuine and authentic. We must engage with the landscape, and this ultimately involves sharing knowledge. Because how on earth can we care for something, or indeed commission it, or look after it, if you do not understand it or have a stake in it? Which is exactly why we set up Landscape Learn. And this is our first event we had in the Bethnal Green Nature Reserve. And this is really to let nature, or natural capital, if you want to talk in planning speak, reveal the answers for us. Thank you very much.
Wow, I think you should get a special prize for finishing before the gong. That's the first time that's happened in the whole Fundamentals series. So, next up, we're going to hear from Stephen Richards of Gillespie's Landscape Architects. Stephen is a partner at Gillespie's with over 25 years UK and international experience in the design and implementation of award-winning public realms and landscapes. He led the work on the landscape design for Neo Bankside behind Tate Modern, the walkie-talkie Sky Garden, and the new public roof garden above the Crossrail station at Canary Wharf. So over to Stephen.
Thank you. I just want to talk about what actually I enjoy so much about landscape, and that is a fundamental attachment to mythology, a fundamental attachment to balance. And I think it often appears in religion, in literature, the idea that there was a time when there was balance. And as we are sort of progressing at such an extraordinary rate through our urban development, a sense of detachment and a sense of longing to recapture this. But what was it? I mean, there is mythologies, there is elements of this time many, many years ago, thousands of years ago, when we did have a sense of connection between our lives as humans and our lives and our association with nature through agriculture and delight. But what it's led on to is something that's very fanciful, and I think it's something that is intrinsically the problem with a lot of the landscape interventions that are happening now within our urban developments. We're almost looking at a nostalgia for a time that none of us have experienced, but there is this idea that when you do bind planting, you do bind nature with architecture, you create this sort of idea of an Eden, you create this idea of something rather beautiful, something again that's in balance. But what we actually really like is the idea that nature is actually reclaiming, nature is coming back in to restore our urban environments. And I think when we look at these sort of images here, the idea of the nature is again reasserting itself, it creates a sort of, again, a fascination, again, something quite fanciful. And we enjoy it, and we enjoy nature, I certainly do, when I'm in environments, this idea that we really can sort of, it appeals to us when these sort of things happen, and it is about reclaiming, it is about balance. But a lot of this results in what we often term, and what Oliver's hinted at earlier in this talk, about greenwash, and about when we do apply nature to buildings, it starts to, it's very worthy, achieves a lot of things, but what is it actually doing? What is actually hiding behind that? And again, the idea that this is an applied approach to buildings, an applied approach to create something that is akin to that time when we were in balance with nature. I think what appeals to me is that it's not just about plants. Landscape is about people. Landscape is about a fundamental relationship we have with outdoor space, a fundamental relationship we have with each other and the spaces that we inhabit. It was a very key manifesto within the modernist movement about the fourth dimension of buildings. And again, this idea of healthy pursuits, healthy to take you away from the street and up into the sky. And this was actually a reaction to dirty streets, but what it was doing was creating a sort of a moment of exterior space that was free, that was, again, it promoted health and well-being. These are not new ideas, you know, this idea, again, of the appropriation of landscape within architecture, the idea of spaces that, the idea of territories that are developed is something, again, has been sort of looked at for many, many, many years, and you know, we've got numerous examples of landscape as it comes together within buildings, from spaces that are very ornamental to spaces that are purely sculpture, in the case of Corbusier, to the Atelier 5, where it's a very beautiful example of landscape and building, to Hundertwasser, where the actual idea of this almost mythological place, a mythological garden within architecture, is manifest. So again, it creates a very sort of an interesting juxtaposition to the street. These are spaces to dream in. These are spaces to delight in. We're working on spaces such as these, and again, I'm going to be up for a lot of debate about these because I think there's a lot of issues attached to these types of schemes. But what we look to do in these is achieve a sense of this idea of, again, reconnection with nature, reconnection with ourselves and others, spaces for relaxation, the idea of gardens that sort of are useful spaces, gardens that are appealing, gardens that work within architecture. Something about that idea that's not just about ecology. It is about ecology, but it's also about people. And again, work that we're doing in the notorious Sky Garden was something again, and I'm very happy to take questions on this. The idea of a space in the sky is something that, again, it's a conceit that has been around for a long time, but it was also something that we felt was kind of interesting, the way it provided space for people to sort of interact and achieve a sense of calm and balance. I'll take questions on this one, but we also touch on there's a debate, but we're also mindful of the sort of the community hubs as well. And I just really want to say that there's, again, the idea of capturing nature within these spaces, and they're very programmed spaces. And I think that they're valuable spaces within cities, within development. This is in the Haygate estate proposals for a variety of moments, interactions, spaces for people to engage in, spaces for people to live. So really it was just to say, that's what interests me. That's how I see landscape and architecture interacting. And I think as part of this debate, I'd like to take that further with you as to the value of the perceived value of this type of landscape intervention.
Wow. Who knew landscape architects were so good at keeping to time? Fantastic. Okay. Next up, we have Richard Reynolds, who describes himself as a guerrilla gardener. He's been guerrilla gardening for the last 13 years. For anyone that doesn't know, that's adopting public land without permission to turn the land into a garden. He's the author of On Guerrilla Gardening and contributor to many other books and publications on the subject of community gardening. Most of his gardens still remain more than a decade on. Some have since been granted permission, although several were recently destroyed by the road widening at Elephant and Castle, which maybe Richard will tell us about. Over to you.
Okay. Thank you very much. I'm going to talk specifically about Elephant and Castle. Elephant and Castle is where I live, it's where I've been for 13 years, and as well as a guerrilla gardener there, I tweet as the roundabout, or the bend, as we now call it, since the roundabout was turned into a bend. Elephant and Castle, to me, is like concentrated London. It's been high-rise for a very long time. It's a vision of the future of London. This view from my window shows the previous folly. So whereas perhaps we're in this era now of greenery being used to dress up design, a few years ago it was environmentally friendly ways of producing electricity, though of course we know those turbines don't turn. So Elephant is the future, everyone, so I'm going to warn you what it's like. A bit about guerrilla gardening. So you've heard what it is. I took over this patch of land to start with. It's the neglected flower bed in front of a council tower block. It's a huge brick planter, and I've been tending it for 13 years. I got permission after year three, and it's a fantastically enjoyable space. It's about people, as we've heard already. This is gardening in the community, not really community gardening. People can access their garden 24 hours a day. It's completely public. In that sense, it's completely vulnerable as well, but it's a very rewarding place as a local resident to be tending, because it's in no way a club. It's for anyone to stop by and chat and take a photo, or occasionally take a flower or an apple, because there's an apple tree behind those foxgloves. So I'm going to show you a few photos of the guerrilla gardening around the area, and then I'm going to go on the attack, because as Winston Churchill, who's so popular these days, as he said, gardening and warfare are the natural pursuits of man. They go together, and as a guerrilla gardener, of course, they're inevitable. My attack is normally with the scarcity of land in a place like Elephant, and with the neglect. Incredibly, those two can exist side by side, although in my 13 years, the neglect is becoming less of the problem, the blight in the area. It's now very much about scarcity. But this is a glorious patch. I've been doing this for 11 years up by Morley College, just north of Elephant and Castle. We call it the London Lavender Field. It was just a grassy traffic island, and now it's full of mostly lavender and fruit trees. And this still has no formal permission at all, but it's doing very well. That's a wide shot of it in all its full summer glory. No CGI here, by the way. Those allium are real. And this is a little pocket park. It's not a pocket park funded by the Mayor's Pocket Park Fund, which are lavishly funded. This was simply a neglected playground on a housing estate that has had about £4,000 of funding in the last 4 years, which is a huge amount of money compared with mostly what I deal with. And it's thriving now. It's just on the edge of the bend up on St George's Road. That's, as you can see, that was last summer. Hollyhocks in full bloom. And a more recent photo, and in fact, I'll be there tomorrow morning. If anyone's free at around 11 o'clock, we're spreading a lot more manure. We just got some funding for some Core 10 steel planters, so we're moving a dogwood around. And there's always something to be doing in these gardens. And it's my friend Nell, who we met through gardening, and now she helps regularly with me. So my first case study, we've already heard a bit about the Haygate, and we're going to hear a bit more. These were my neighbours, similar era council block, much bigger than the block I live in, this whole estate, 1,300 homes, originally obviously social housing. And this is a photo that a lot of people don't normally see. When the Haygate was dramatised in movies or in sort of blogs about urban landscape, it normally look away from the trees, but Tim Tinker, the architect, had 450 large specimens planted in the early 70s, and you could see they were glorious by 2011 when this was taken. And I joined together with local residents to launch a campaign in 2011 called Elephant and Castle Urban Forest, which was raising awareness of that green infrastructure to put pressure on Lendlease, Stephen's clients, to embrace this and to incorporate it. It was a win-win situation for them. Other people, and they still are, campaigning about the lack of affordable housing here. But we took up this particular issue and did a lot in 2011 to raise awareness of it. And that the website's still there as an archive. And guerrilla gardening played a part, but it was very much a branding exercise as well. The urban forest in this CGI appears to still be there. Everything is green. It's almost as if there's been a kind of climate change and everything's gone a bit kind of mossy, really. But this is an aspiration, and it's certainly an aspiration I welcome, although the increasing density of what was already a quite high-density landscape is shocking. I wish I had the figure for you, but this is mass increase in density. And what's fascinating is that Lendlease really seemed to have embraced this greening thing. So that despite the fact that this publicly owned space that was publicly accessible 24 hours a day is being marketed by Lendlease and propagated by the Evening Standard as Central London's largest park for 70 years, largest new park, when in fact it's been there all along. It just wasn't marketed as such. And of course, that's become the brand itself. It is Elephant Park. So I have mixed feelings about this, because in a way I feel we kind of handed them this as a strategy, and they've completely run with it. Orchard Point, West Grove, everything's tree-related. They've even unearthed an historic street called Ash Street, which is going to be rebuilt. And despite all that amazing land and all the trees, and we did manage to save some of them, it's the roof gardens where they've got really excited. But they're not called roof gardens, they're not even called community gardens, they're called grow gardens. Because unlike a normal garden, I suppose it grows. I'm running out of time. This is disastrous. But they're not for you to go. Although they're kind of for you to grow. They plant the carrots ready for you. This is the leader of Southwark Council. This is before any residents moved in, and the residents are a bit baffled about this. I'll flick past this one. But the roof garden habit is very catching locally. These are the Toblerone Towers, 150 metres tall. Sadiq granted permission because they had a roof garden. But for me, it's the street garden that's worrying, because it's not going to be built. You'll have to go online to find out about the roundabout, but this is the tragedy. We'll flick past this. Elephant and Castle Roundabout has been marketed as a great place, a new great place, and it's not, because that's what it used to be like. This is what they promised, loads of new trees and green infrastructure. They did visualizations that made it look like a kind of village green. And Witherford Watson Mann and others produced these lavish visuals of fruit trees. They said that it would recognize plants, stories and people, cherries, acacias, urban apple growing. They even took one of my photos. They just nicked a photo of mine showing us doing our lavender harvest. Not a single species listed here in the consultation actually got planted. Even the cherries, they use ornamental ones in the end, not the fruiting ones. The whole thing was bullshit. And they chopped down more trees than they said they would. They haven't planted that many. In fact, we've ended up in the press complaining about it. That's the cherry, the ornamental cherry grove. Nettles and bindweed growing in their new flower beds within months of being built last year. Flooded piazzas. It's a complete fiasco. And they're marketing it. They've spent £87,000 marketing this place since they built it as this public space that's been transformed. You see, they're much more concerned about that than about the transport. We came up with the alternative image. You know, it was not a good junction. You know, don't get me wrong, but it's been made far worse. Two deaths, by the way, two deaths since it opened. I'm demanding where the trees are. I'm not just protesting. We've been guerrilla gardening. We've gone back. So this is a new tree that went in, and my family and I there, we've just done a nice little neat little ring of rosemary, and it's stuffed full of allium and tulips that will be coming up in spring. That's my final slide. Thank you.
Wonderful. So there you have it. Bad landscape design can cause death. Who knew? Next up, we have Anna Minton, writer, journalist, and academic. She's author of Ground Control, Fear and Happiness in the 21st Century, which if you haven't read, you should. It was my Bible when I was a student. She's a regular contributor to The Guardian, The Architectural Review, and many other titles. She's a reader in architecture at the University of East London, where she teaches a programme called Reading the Neoliberal City. And a quick plug for her new book about the housing crisis called Big Capital, Who is London For? Will be published by Penguin in June. So over to Anna.
Okay, I don't normally, I don't normally follow someone who's been on that tack. I'm normally the attack speaker, so it's a bit more difficult, but anyway. I'm just going to show you some images first, and then we'll talk about them. So that is Canary Wharf, One Canada Square. That is the Broadgate Centre. This is Liverpool One, 34 streets, 43 hectares in the heart of Liverpool. And like every sizable new development in the UK, including the one we are in right now, it's privately owned, privately controlled, policed by security guards, CCTV covering every inch of the site, as I was told by one of the developers involved with Liverpool One. So this is the way we've been creating all our developments, our public spaces, our streets, our squares for the last 10 to 15 years. And this is the High Line, already been mentioned, in New York. I don't know very much about the history of the High Line. I don't know about whether or not it was a bottom-up project and how it has subsequently turned out. What I do know, I believe, is that it is a privately owned space, just like our very own possible, not as yet shown tonight, Garden Bridge, privately owned. We've talked about that, and I'm sure there would be security guards controlling those groups of more than six people with the things they may or may not be allowed to do on that bridge. And there was meant to be one more slide there, but it's not there. It was going to be of East Village and the Olympic Park, another recent privately owned development. So just to sort of give you an idea of some of these spaces, I'm sure you're all very familiar with them. And at this point, people normally say to me, well, you know, these are our great estates. They're the great estates of today. And I mean, if you look at this image, this is Bedford Square. It is indeed one of the nicest parts of London, our Georgian squares and terraces. And they were built on this great estate model. These were privately owned places built by the aristocrats, the dukes and earls of the time, who've now been replaced by corporate landlords, with the exception of the Duke of Westminster, who remains in place as the head of Grosvenor. And they are wonderful. But of course, what you don't see today is that in the 18th century and early 19th century, this was surrounded by high gates and fences. There was a sentry box, there were security guards, and the public were not allowed in. And this was the focus of massive, massive protest, actually, as local democracy and local government, central government, became more democratic, democracy grew in power. These protests are not known about today, but actually tens of thousands of people massed to demonstrate against this. It led to two acts of parliament in the mid-19th century, and ultimately the creation of the London County Council ensured that the aristocrats had to open up these large parts of the city to the general public. The gates were taken down, and local authorities henceforth adopted the streets and public places, to use the jargon. And that's why we've had this idea that, of course, the streets are public. They've always been public, and so they'll always continue to remain so. But they have not always been public. This was a hard-won democratic achievement. And my argument is that actually the privatisation of estates, while we're not always necessarily gated, it may be a more covert rather than overt exclusion. But that is putting this democratic achievement into reverse. And I think a pretty good example of this is Paternoster Square, home to the London Stock Exchange, another private estate, a little less green, this one, but nonetheless. You will be familiar with this image, the Occupy protest, 2011, outside St. Paul's Cathedral, which in the event provided a dramatic backdrop for the protest, but they never intended to be there. They intended to be in Paternoster Square, which is where the Stock Exchange is. They were meant to be called Occupy London Stock Exchange. But actually, it emerged that the entire city of London is now a series of privately owned estates. And the only public land left in the square mile is this space here, and actually a very small space outside the Bank of England, where demonstrations regularly gather. Because these spaces regulate and control behaviour very, very strongly. A whole range of activities is not allowed. No skateboarding, rollerblading, cycling, eating or drinking, filming, and absolutely, definitely no political protest, homelessness, begging. They're not democratic spaces in the way that we understand democratic spaces. Very quickly, Haygate again, talked about already, 3,000 homes for people of on predominantly low incomes, demolished in 2014, and replaced by what we've already seen tonight. And I think this is a key point, really, to bear in mind, that those 3,000 homes have not only been replaced by the wonderful garden, which I'm sure will indeed be lovely, but also by 2,500 luxury apartments, of which only 79 are social housing, and these are the prices. So it's not only a greening of the city, it's actually a greening of the city which is accompanying a huge demographic change in the city. Okay, I'm pretty much almost done. So after that really dismal and depressing set of slides, I have one positive slide. You know, can you show us an example of where it can be done differently? Yes, really easily. This is Brixton Central Square. It probably cost, you know, a million or two to rejig a bit a few years ago. It's not private. It's got no security guards. It works really well as a space. It's not really dangerous. I mean, it's not rocket science. So I'll stop there.
Excellent. Thank you, Anna. So finally, we are going to hear from Tim Waterman, who's senior lecturer in landscape architecture at the University of Greenwich and a thesis tutor at the Bartlett. And he's probably the most qualified person to be here because he's written a book called Fundamentals of Landscape Architecture, which we should have had on sale on a little stall. He's co-author of several other textbooks, from urban design to landscape and agency, and he's currently working on a book titled The Handbook of Landscape and Food. So over to Tim.
Okay, let's see if I can work this. Oh. Right, so Thank you, Ollie, and thank you, Central St. Martins. My talk is entitled The Global Cucumber, and this will all become clear in a moment. I know it's very perplexing right now. And I would like to take you to the Milan Expo in 2015, which was entitled Feeding the Planet, Energy for Life. I don't want to paint this as a completely villainous event, because there were some really good things that actually happened in the master planning process. 50% of each pavilion site was given over to landscape, and 50% was for the building. So it was acknowledging that there was a relationship between building and landscape that was necessary for sustainability. And in fact, McDonald's got it. Although Turkmenistan, right next to them, didn't quite. They filled the whole site. Now, this didn't go down well, though, necessarily, with the Milanese. There were protests in the streets and a lot of ill will towards all of the processes of the expo. This is the reason that what this expo was doing was representing Milan's food and landscape culture to the world, and this is what the world was seeing, was the global food giants that had moved in, wormed their way into these contracts at the last minute. Coca-Cola, McDonald's, all of these kinds of things part of the whole mix. So, beware. I was speaking to one of the workers there, a man named Stefano Bisi, and he tells me, nobody is making any money out of this except for the guys who are pouring the concrete. This is not good for Milan. And in the course of the discussion, he says, cryptically, we must beware the global cucumber. And so sort of scratching my head, all becomes clear when he explains it to me, and he kind of inches up to the wall, and he says, we have to protect our behinds from the global cucumber. So naturally, what he's talking about is processes of globalization, financialization, neoliberalism that make themselves apparent. So beware the global cucumber. Here's a few other things from the Milan Expo. Austria, nature reloaded. What are we going to do? Shoot it out of a cannon? And then American food 2.0. Reloaded again. This was a mechanically undulating living wall filled with lettuces and fennel and that kind of thing. The design concept by D-Land Landscape Architects was that this was to evoke American amber waves of grain and lettuce and fennel. And some people just didn't get it at all. So this is the Duomo, it's a landscape space. I call it Virgin in the Mist. And everything at the Milan Expo was actually, I mean, this form was everywhere. And I think it was coming from Singapore's Gardens by the Bay that this becomes the shape that announces to the world that your site is sustainable and green. And the term I've come up for it is that this is the vuvuzela form, after the vuvuzela used in South Africa. And to prove the point that this is high design, we get a few of Heatherwick's sit and spins. Also happening in Milan at this time is a recreation of Agnes Dennis's wheat field, a confrontation with Stefano Boeri's Bosco Verticale, floating behind it like a CGI. And in fact, no matter where you are in Milan looking at it, it looks like a bloody CGI. They've built a CGI. And here's the original, 1982, Agnes Dennis, a confrontation in New York. Incredible power to this image and incredible power to the project, talking about agriculture and its relationship to the city and so many other things with a blasted New York behind. New York in 1982 was not a happy place. And this image of determination, I think, says all sorts of things about the power of women, the power of agriculture, the power of land, the power of landscape. And this is what we got in Milan. A polished hoarding and the wheat field, and all plonked down in the middle of a neoliberal development. And here's some of the tourists saying, WTF. And here's the Bosco Verticale itself. You always see the CGI pictures, but here it is at ground level, as seen in Google Street View, and it's gated. it meets the ground incredibly badly with these mirrored glass walls. It's basically telling this working class neighborhood that it's plunked itself down in the middle of, fuck you. The thing that makes me really happy is actually that working class neighborhood is still kind of going on just fine. And the other thing that's going on just fine is this living wall right next to it, which is brick and a bit of ivy, and it's bloody flourishing and it's full of birds. We might get the hint that the global cucumber is at work here too. And I just wanted to show you right at the very last one project that is particularly exciting me. In cash-strapped Spain, in Girona, in Catalonia, Estudi Martí Franch is gardening the city, working with what they call genius temporum, the genius of times, genius of the seasons. And this is a diagram that they've created to talk about the relationship that they have with the landscape management crews. So the spaces are being designed through processes of management in a very engaged kind of way. And it's big. It's lots of tiny projects, but it's scaled at the scale of all of Girona. So you get walking itineraries and green infrastructure. And it's making the landscape legible and giving the people access to the city by actually just kind of doing a bit of pruning here and there, removing trees here, planting others there. It's very low cost, and it's been a way for the landscape architect to find work in a cash-strapped environment. Really, really beautiful project and very, very sensitive. So I would encourage you to look at his work, and above all, to beware of the global cucumber.
Great. Well, I think we'll leave the global cucumber looming menacingly behind the panel. If I can invite the speakers to come and join me on the sofas.
Are you going to be able to sit on that?
I think you're going to have to. Well, where to begin? Blimey. Beneath the cucumber. I think we can all concentrate with that in the background.
I feel threatened by it.
I suppose the one thing that came out to me in all of the presentations is how much we expect landscape to do these days. Like, from whatever position we're coming from, whether we're the developer who's using it to say, you know, it's adding biodiversity and visual amenity and, you know, rainwater runoff and kind of cleansing our facade, or whether you're the kind of community doing your own bottom-up thing, are we actually kind of putting too much pressure on landscape to perform from whichever angle that we're coming from? Do you think that's why there are so many projects that fail, in a way, that there's so much vested in the kind of miracle, escapist, exotic powers of the potential of landscape?
I don't know. I think that there's a lack of... On some projects, there's a lack of real engagement with site, and so some of the projects aren't adopted by the neighbourhoods around because they're meaningless. So I think that there is good examples which have been shown, or just with the panel, of projects that have emerged out of the ground, which will then inevitably be more sustainable, which will be loved, which will be nurtured, because they mean something. So I think there is a terrible danger. I mean, we had an interesting thing, because we've talked a lot about Elephant and Castle. So we had Lendlease come to see our project, which was a collaboration between Muff and ourselves at Making Space in Dalston, where everything, the brief for every project in that little kind of patchwork of interventions was grown out of conversations with the people who lived there and knew it best. And they wanted to purchase the idea. So Mary and Brian, who are in the audience, who are fantastic people, and myself, gave our time for a good couple of hours, didn't we? And actually, you've done it a couple of times. We took them round, we told them exactly how it went, and they just wanted to know the figures, how much, you know. That, and then they just took it away. They didn't even write a thank you letter or anything, or donate to the garden. So I think there is this purchasing that goes on quite often by developers, rather than actually understanding the intent or the reasons why some projects.
Does that mean it's automatically going to fail? Does something have to come from the bottom up to be successful?
No, I don't think it
Stephen.
Does.
No, not at all. And I think a lot of the work that we're engaged with is there is a scale to it. There is a complexity to it. There is there's a cost attached to it. I mean, the examples that I gave you, they're very expensive. So they have to sort of, in terms of what's invested in those roofs and those places. So there's a lot of discussion about what does it actually bring. And I suppose those are pieces of big infrastructure. So they don't, as a rule, have that the reach out to the sort of the groundswell, the community. We'd like to, these are commercial propositions. And I suppose that comes with a price. It comes with an attitude to what we're trying to achieve.
But how do you make your clients take landscape kind of seriously, rather than it being a kind of garnish or something to, a decoy for the planning officer? How can you actually make them think of it as the central part of the scheme, not something that gets value engineered straight away?
I go back to what I mentioned in my little piece. What fascinates us is that these are spaces for people to come together, and the engagement in gardens, the engagement in spaces can happen, I believe, within these structures. Now, they're often pilloried because of what they sort of represent, and they seem detached, but the Sky Garden has 50,000 people a month in there, and I've been many times to see it, and those people are enjoying it, and those people are finding an expression within those spaces that they don't often find within the streets and plazas. There's something different about those spaces, and often how we promote them is that idea that people will engage with those spaces, and that's what we hope to achieve.
Yeah, I mean, I'd possibly say the Sky Garden is, I don't know if my thing is on.
Yeah.
The Sky Garden is something a bit different because it's an interior rather than what I would feel. I'm not a landscape architect, but for me, landscape is outside, and it's, well, perhaps that's wrong.
No, I agree. I've been thinking the same.
If we talk about external landscapes, one of the questions for me is when you have a space which is very controlled, very monitored, that inevitably impacts on the not just the activities, but the culture, the atmosphere of the space. Mm. And that interacts with landscape, so that landscape just becomes a backdrop and an ornament rather than actually the sort of interactive process. And I would have thought that might be a concern. I mean, I'm sure that the Elephant Park will be beautiful, like parts of the Olympic Park are, beautifully, beautifully done. But I suspect we'll still have that sterility. And I know those managers don't want that sterility.
Yeah. Richard, how can you avoid that sterility?
Beauty is one tiny part of what a landscape should be. And back to your original point, I agree that we should be expecting a lot from our landscape. Beauty, social, environmental benefits, we should be aspiring to that. But the first mistake, and we've seen it this evening, is in the marketing before it's even built. So that's how it's playing a huge role at the moment. And this isn't just a fuss about bad CGI. This is about the whole picture that the landscape architect and the developer takes on to market their development. I mean, we, with all due respect, we saw images of cherry blossom and echinacea in bloom at the same time. And even with our freaky weather conditions, that's just not fair. And a landscape architect should be going back to his visualizer saying, no. But to me, that's symbolic of the overpromise. Then it comes to the landscape itself. Well, of course, it's going to fail on one count, even if it's just horticultural coherence. But for me, this is where I concede guerrilla gardening is not the answer to everything. It cannot always be bottom-up unless the developer, the public owner, has no interest in the landscape, unless it's pretty much just a neglected wasteland, which, of course, in a big city isn't going to be the case. So what I would love to see is that hard landscape, the
the open ground, but the hard landscape around it, the kind of the facility, the container for a landscape to be provided, whether it's by the public or private sector, but to work more closely with existing and future residents about how you then grow it. And that's where the bottom-up bit becomes. And that's why seeing the pre-grown carrots and knowing residents who've moved in there who are baffled about what to do, who fear that future seasons will only look inferior compared with what the highly paid maintenance people do, is so frustrating. It's such a simple thing to get right. Let them move in with empty ground.
In a situation where you don't know your future user, which is a lot of the time in our kind of speculative development scenario, how can we ensure that the landscape is something that's taken seriously and kind of embedded maybe before the buildings come? Are there examples where that's happened, where the landscape is the kind of first thing to arrive on a site?
The problem with this is embedded in the whole development model, which seeks the largest possible cleared site and then builds upon it, that actually we really need to be looking at ways that we can build the city in more incremental ways so that you're not having to train a whole new community how to use their space. And I think one of the problems with thinking about landscape as something that really has to deliver all of this stuff is actually in the way that landscape is so often conceived, is that it's a discrete space, a bounded space that then has to deliver. And actually, landscape is all of the city. It is the city and how it connects with the countryside. It's a worked, lived, engaged in sort of place. And in Henri Lefebvre's conception of the city, which he sees as a work, a collective work over time, then that's, you know, if that's the model that we bring to our understanding of the landscape and the city, then it becomes a place that you can't kind of attack in these massive ways, the giant tabula rasa. And we have to look for more models like community land trusts and such that actually allow people to have an active engagement in their spaces.
So often, I suppose, you know, we had some examples in the presentations of gardening and agriculture being used as a form of kind of activism, as an oppositional tool to top-down development. But so often those things also get swept away. So the Dalston Eastern Curve garden, which came up briefly, maybe we could talk a bit more about that in depth, how it began as another mini version of the Agnes Dennis wheat field, and then Joe designed a more kind of permanent garden. But I guess that's still threatened by commercial development
like
somehow.
That's not how the project evolved. I mean, landscape is a process, and ecology isn't like people and ecology. We're part of the ecosystem. We have to start to understand that, because as soon as we do, then we feel like we've got some part to play. We're not just viewing it. We're not just clipping it. We're actually part of the narrative. And I just think we can't, you know, geology runs under territories for miles and miles. That's what connects us. So in going back to Dalston, it was something that really came out of a huge planning debacle, which was anger at the London Development Agency, as they were then, and TfL and the GLA, just plonking down a huge, great big development and just clearing the Four Aces Club, for one thing. Mm. So, you know, then we were asked to come and repair. And I said, well, we need 6 months to even start conversations with people who... So there is a natural timing. You know, we've evolved as a species, but not that fast. We still all go to the loo. We still need to see each other, talk to each other. We still love eye contact. So whatever happens, those kind of human interactions is pretty much to do with sort of simple courtesy, asking about places and how they operate and what the community's like, but it's also to do with sharing knowledge and understanding. And that's just normal human behavior. So I can't bear it when, like you, Richard, there was a development up the road which used some of our consultation photographs for their design and access statement. the evolution, we saw the Dalston Eastern Curve as an evolution, but what we had to do was convince our client really build trust and also confidence that strange little places could the perception of those places could change and could be meaningful. Yeah. And so that was part of the process. It wasn't a purchasing of that. That was the Barbican coming in.
Yeah. Yeah. I mean, both of you mentioned your kind of disdain that your kind of bottom-up, to use that overused phrase, gardening projects were then exploited in some way or used in marketing by other developers. Is that a failure or actually a success?
No, it was
of,
a success.
Of the power?
For me, when I saw it, it was obviously there was a little bit of annoyance, but actually, when I saw that they had an image of a fruit tree that was just sort of, I don't know, Getty image or something, I said, well, I've got an elephant, a castle, roundabout fruit tree that's been there for... Use that one too. Give it a credit. No, brilliant. Because I liked their vision. It was wonderful to think that we might have loads of lavender at the Elephant and Castle roundabout and fruit trees. This was great.
But is
the fact is, they didn't build it. It was just marketing fluff to sell a dodgy transport project.
I think it is also to do with not just discarding anyone. I mean, I think the client bodies, there are many different types of client bodies, and we need to be generous enough and convincing enough to say that bringing the landscape up first, investing a lot below ground in stuff which isn't sexy and you can't see, but which will give a tree a life of 500 years whatever, is important.
But in
but
some
you
ways,
need to give confidence.
Community gardens are kind of the ultimate tool of gentrification, in a sense, in the same way as street markets, the things that cause the value uplift of the surrounding area. Is that something dangerous that we should be aware of, or is it inevitable?
I really don't agree, and I think, again, elephant's a good example, because there is, there was me guerrilla gardening, there were other people guerrilla gardening, there were community gardens, there's a lot going on there for a very long time, a lot that predates me, that Lendlease see us as a thorn in their side that they have pacified to some extent. And I collaborated with them for several years in a project called Mobile Gardeners, which was using interim use to create a community garden space. And I had high hopes for it. And given that Lendlease appeared to be talking the right kind of language, I had high hopes that they would be a supportive landlord. But they weren't. It's into its third phase now. I'm no longer involved in what's now called Grow Elephant. Because at every phase, they ended the project earlier than they said they would. At every phase, they made basic provision of water and electricity, either non-existent or very hard to obtain. And in a good way, they never bothered even marketing what we were doing or helping us spread the message in the community. We were, for most of the project, hidden away down a cul-de-sac, doing all the marketing ourselves. So where they put their investment was in marketing the work that Gillespie's would be selling to their development. You weren't buying into the idea of an existing community with a garden at all. You're buying into something that your service charge will presumably have to pay for until you're fed up with
it. This problem does exist and has existed for a long time, that actually communities create value for themselves, and when they do, it can create problems. Carl Lynn, the American anarchist landscape architect, noted that rents would go up when people made their own community gardens.
But I think you have to differentiate between a sort of fairly gradual process of gentrification and this extreme development frenzy that we're seeing at the moment, which is surrounded by these lush gardens. Mm. I mean, they're completely different things.
Stephen, do you ever feel compromised if it seems like one of your landscape designs is actually being used as a very cynical tool to sell a development or to win planning permission for, a tower in an area where towers shouldn't be allowed, for example?
Well, it's the reality of the world we're in, isn't it? the reality of how these things are marketed, and we find ourselves, producing this information. And yes, it is challenging for us as professionals to do that. But I think it's that case that we're challenged. We want to do the best. We want to create beautiful spaces. We want to create something that's uplifting for the people who are there. The issues of interaction that really fascinate me on the sort of the new communities, because the work we do is very, very big and very fast. And it is, again, that sense of instant sort of gratification almost. It's seen in the visualizations, it's seen in the work that we're asked to do. It's because these developments need to be sold that whole idea of that sort of capability Brown approach, that this is for so many generations to come. We don't live in that world now with the way the developers where the way development is happening.
But is there a way for the landscape to come first? I mean, Joe, you know, you've worked on large-scale commercial projects yourself, like Ruskin Square. You know, how
we fight the whole time, all the way through, and give Stanhope their credit. You know, we said, you must make this permeable. You must make the whole space. None of this is permeable here. This is all mortar jointed. You've got to have a grit joint. There's something poetic about the grit joint because a weed can grow in it, but also the water can get down, and then you can recycle that water. But it was a long journey with them, and they stuck with us. But we were prepared to be fired, basically, if we felt that what we were. That we couldn't meet on any common ground. So there's been huge investment below the ground that no one would know about. We managed to persuade Stanhope to retain a funny old tree, because why not? Just because it was category C on the arboricultural report didn't mean that it didn't have value. But that was a big deal for them. But Croydon were really delighted. So T1... rules in Croydon, but it's a small thing. But you know, Stanhope did gradually come on board, and you know, working with Liza on that, and it's been an exploration. So hopefully, it will have some texture and some feeling that of nature and of a special sense of place as a result. But really, when we finish, or when our contracts come to an end, that's when the landscape starts. And I think the really huge opportunity, because the public-private kind of partnering of delivering of public realm is the only way that public realm can be delivered, pretty much, because there's no money with the councils. There has to be a better... sense of responsibility for the aftercare. It can't be done by cleansing contractors. There's a huge opportunity for skilling up gardeners on these schemes, however commercial they are, and having the management and the nurturing of these spaces done in a completely different way.
But that can only be handled by the private sector, are we saying? Are we basically submitting ourselves to the future of business improvement?
No, partnerships.
Districts doing this elaborate gardening for us, or communities doing it? Or how can we manage these spaces if there's no public money left?
No, I think it's done in partnership, and the local authorities have to be very firm in what they're demanding.
But I mean, I think it would require a really different vision of the city and what we want for city space, because the vision of the city is that spaces should be clean and safe. That's the mantra. That's the guidelines for business improvement districts, according to the New York Mayor's Office, which
it's
we've
rewilding.
Important.
It's about
well,
rewilding.
Well, OK, rewilding
now.
is in. I give you that. But I think all those managers of business improvement districts are working to clean and safe.
Well, there's a collaboration between all the so-called great estates at the moment, which has got a very corny title to it, which is something like Go West or Wild West or something like that. But it's an intent, a genuine intent about nature in the city and about looking at opportunities. And Grosvenor know that all their gardens are cut off from any use apart from the gardeners, and they've got massive vacancy, and it's a really huge issue for them.
Are we getting better at allowing things to be wild, Stephen? Are some of your clients up for a bit more wilderness, or is everything always have to be very manicured and
I think
clean?
Questions of scale, really. I think when we're dealing with such small spaces and the intensity of use, then there is an intensity of management. And I think it's one of the big issues we have, I share this, with a lot of the work that we're doing is the aftercare, because the landscape is dynamic. And it's not just about plants. It's about, you know, how people have used it. It's almost that sort of idea of when you see the sheep trails going through landscape, that's when the path comes afterwards. And we've worked on projects where we've come back later and seen how people develop it. And it's always fascinating to me how when in my field, it is almost that instant landscape to revisit it, to work with an enlightened client who said, well, let's change this, let's move it forward, let's do something different with it. And nature will out anyway. I mean, this is, you know, the idea that we're terribly sort of grand, aren't we, in the way that we sort of control nature, and we let it in or we choose to not let it in, and I think it's there.
But is nature strong enough to win in London? I'm not convinced.
There's a photo I flicked through. It showed Verbena bonaeriensis growing out of a crack in the pavement in St Mary's Gardens in Kennington. Mm-hmm. And actually that whole, it's a very fancy little part of Kennington, but I walked through it from Elephant to drop my daughter to a nursery 3 days a week. And it's just been left to go wild. I mean, the grass is that high in the curb. Mm-hmm. And this isn't some kind of, you know, hipster corner of Vauxhall or anything. It's very swanky around there, Jaguars and all. But they're just not doing the streets. But it's amazing. Lambeth have abandoned it. It's brilliant.
There's a decision. There's no pristine landscapes left on this earth. Everything is influenced by man, some way. Yeah. And so everything's a conscious decision. So, yes,
but
it can go wild.
Do you think that's a decision by the council to allow that bit of...
Oh, I think it's an accident. It's an accident that's to do with the cutbacks in cleanliness and all. Yeah. Mm-hmm. But I think it's also, at best, the residents are probably complicit with it, because surely someone around there, if they had an issue, would have complained. Or you know, a house-proud owner would have got out with their hoe and cleared it away. But it's been like that... Since June, no one's cleared it at all, and it's wonderful.
It raises the issue of public sector streets which are public, are a bit scruffy. Mm. You just have to come here and you cross the road from the private bit across the public street. It's a bit scruffy. There's nothing wrong with it, but it's a bit scruffy. Scruffy's kind of cosy. Mm. And actually, this pristineness is not very... welcome.
This is why a lot of landscape schemes are actually attacked when they're installed. People will vandalize trees because they see the trees that are planted in a street as they're the harbingers of gentrification. And that's a real problem, you know, because those trees are, you know, good for people's health and all of the other benefits, but to have them be seen in that way.
It's about acceptance, isn't it? And that does take an awful long time. And I think, you know, again, this idea of instant landscape, and it's slowly developed. You know, when you look at the big urban plans of Houseman and people like that, you know, they were attacks on, you know, the wholesale almost social cleansing, those sort of things. Now they're seen as the archetype of the most beautiful streetscape that we have on this planet. So it is about, you know, it is about time, and landscape's about time, and I think it's about adaptation, and it's about an acceptance from us all that this is something that should change and should be adapted.
There's a mismatch between political cycles and landscape, which should be long-term vision, and it's a really... You know, mayoral cycles is not going
to
do it.
I was going to ask this precise question. Yeah, if we zoom out a bit and talk a bit about mayoral strategies. So we had Ken Livingstone's 100 public spaces, about, 20 of which actually happened, maybe? Mm. Then Boris took on the programme and rebranded it. Boris's Great Outdoors. what do we make, and I don't know what Sadiq's is called, to be honest, but what do we make of the successive mayor's, you know, bigger strategic approach to landscape in London? Things like the Green Grid,
The All London Green Grid was a fantastic initiative, because in a sense it's what you're talking about. It was talking about valuing, connecting, and putting first or identifying first all that that resource ahead of development, and also picking up opportunities which maybe needed only a small intervention in order to unlock. So it was a brilliant initiative which is being reviewed at the moment and may in fact turn out to be National Park City or whatever. I feel a rebranding coming on. But it doesn't matter. It means the same. It's about being opportunistic and about thinking strategically and considering our blue landscape as well as our green, as well as, you know, the grey, all in a kind of ecological patchiness that is meaningful. There isn't a huge amount. I mean, there's a lot of the mayoral agenda rests very firmly with air quality, And so, you know, our urban forest is vital for that. And we've got 20% canopy cover in London at the moment, where Shenzhen, you could say trees and democracy don't go. They're a very new city, and they've got 40%.
40%. So,
you know, it's a dynamic. We can't just go, oh, we've got 20%, that's okay. Mm. We constantly need to be working at planting trees, because they are as much part of the identity of London as its architecture.
Richard, what do you make of mayoral policy?
I think it might sound contradictory, but the emphasis on placemaking from successive mayors, I think, is wrong. Particularly when it's accompanied, as Boris has done, with this greening, of which the Garden Bridge is the most ridiculous, because he's creating a place from a bit of river. When his priorities, particularly given that the biggest budget a mayor has is transport, the priority should be all the benefits that need to come from transport, including clean air. And I think both those mayors, our first two mayors, have been distracted a bit. I think it's a bit unfair on Ken, really. The issue is mainly with Boris. And Sadiq needs to step up and not get distracted by the superficial greenery and fix the problems and use greenery as part of it.
What Boris did was really an abuse of a system that had developed. So much of London's landscapes have to be delivered on the back of Transport for London schemes, because there's no central unitary authority that can work with these with planning for London's landscape as a whole.
Yeah. Transport for London becomes the de facto. They have significant budget.
Yeah, well, the Crossrail scheme particularly, I guess. Yeah. Was your client TfL for that directly, or no? So your the garden. How was that process?
It was Canary Wharf themselves, actually. Right. So
the funding is actually generally from a private sector.
Exactly.
The consequence of getting the objective wrong is that with Boris it was about, we've got to plant a certain number of trees, but then as an annual target that meant, and there's a PDF you can download of the examples near me, they didn't look after them, but then that means they need to replant them again, and then they're hitting their planting target. Whereas actually if you're thinking about air quality, then you realise a big, mature, healthy tree is going to deliver that better, so you might as well not chop the big, mature, healthy tree down in the first place.
Mm. There's another sort of irony to all of this, is that if the money that was spent on the Garden Bridge could be put into landscape works across London, we would be delivering all that benefit to local communities and dealing with drainage problems, which might mean that actually through all that landscape that we could say, well, maybe we don't need the Thames Tideway Tunnel. So let's spend that money on landscape too.
Which itself is coming with a whole series of public realm improvements.
Yeah, but little bits here and there.
But, there is a slight, you know, optimistic note in that TfL have just issued their sustainable urban drainage guidance. So the drainage engineer has now got to a little bit think about biodiversity and amenity as well as water quality and quantity. That's a huge, we helped author that. It was a massive project, but there it does show that in, you know, if they want to deliver, the mayor wants to deliver its healthy streets, which is one of its strategies, then that has to be meaningful.
Okay, I think it's time to unleash our roving microphone and take some questions. The first hand was here, and the second one, over there.
Hello. I wanted to ask about the role landscape, sort of the direction it takes. So in architecture, you know, if you're designing a nursery, you know that's what you're going to be designing. And then it might change onto designing a health unit. But how does the role of that particular scheme change, or gives examples of how that changes on a case-by-case basis as a landscape designer? Is it always to make things, as you've noted, sort of bring a community sense to it, or is it to beautification? Just to talk a bit about that. And then on a slightly more mundane point, what's the future of London parking in relation to landscaping, and how do you envision that?
Interesting. Parking. But yeah, so the first one was about how the role of landscape changes according to the brief, the programme of the project.
It's very set in architecture sometimes, and you can go, oh, this is what I'm doing. But in landscape, as someone who hasn't really studied much of that, you're like, well, what's the brief?
Do you guys have more of an open brief with the landscape, or is it just as precise?
Oh, well, we're lucky if we get one. or a good one. And actually, the best landscape brief that I've ever had was one for Maggie's Centre that we're doing at the moment, where there's a complete recognition of nature and architecture and well-being. But generally, they're quite poor documents. But that's quite good because it gives us quite a lot of leeway to develop the programme. And every single site is different. We look from the geology and the archaeology up. And according to the actual programme that has got to be delivered on the surface, those make the places and the solutions and the options inevitably emerge together with conversations with those who live around and on the site. So it's never, the landscape is a process. The city is a landscape. It's not, you can't just, a visualization is quite dangerous with landscape because there's a tremendous amount of ephemeral qualities, you know, the senses, what you're smelling, what you're seeing, that moment, that particular fall of shadow and the play of light is momentary. And so just to plaster at that moment in time behind or in front of an image of a structure, you've got to really understand where that's come from, because otherwise it will be a big disappointment because you won't understand what it is it takes to sustain or evolve, because they're dynamic. Whatever we want to do, when we finish, those trees are hopefully going to go on growing. There will be fashions and floristic fashions. There will be all sorts of things that come in and out. And the structure of what you've dealt with needs to be locked in, I believe, firmly to the people in the place.
Stephen.
Totally fascinated about the interaction of landscape and architecture, and I think the best architecture out there has a landscape, a part of it. Now, that's not necessarily a garden, it's not necessarily planted. It's more of an atmosphere, more of a setting. You could be working on a museum and it's a civic space. There's always a lovely story I heard about the Salk Institute by Louis Kahn. He asked two landscape architects to look at it. One filled it with trees because he thought this was what it needed. You know, it needed to be humanized, it needed to be a wonderful sort of forest within this building. Louis Barragan came and he said, this doesn't need trees. This is an extraordinary space and it's all about captured sky. And I think that's when, you know, landscape and architecture come together in a very beautiful, poetic way. It is, as Joe was saying, so much to do with the programme. You know, the landscape for housing, the landscape for a hospital, the landscape for a school, the landscape for a prison, because these are all set buildings that are set in landscapes. But intrinsically, they have to be
sort of monocultures, can they? I mean, the multifunctional nature of landscape is essential, isn't it?
Yes, no, I understand that. I also love the idea that there's a spiritualism to landscape, and we oft that hackneyed phrase "sense of place" is used. But when you walk through a grove of a single species of tree, there's something rather extraordinary about the magnificence of nature in that. It's, you know, it's the forest, the true forest. Often as not, we as landscape architects are criticized for trying to capture little bits of ecology, little bits of biodiversity, and they look hokey, they look foolish. We're actually something rather sort of more sublime and grand and more... because again, I go back to, yes, it is about ecology, it's about people, it's about our connection and something rather deeper as well that comes through them.
I want to come at the question just slightly differently because I think that buildings and landscapes, cities and countryside need to be thought together, that we consistently separate them and pigeonhole them, but they need to be conceived of together. And this is not by one sort of master architect, master landscape architect, but rather by groups of people who are addressing it together. We really need to change the structure of practice so that there's not a leader per se, but that we're all working with it together. And I think it's importantly in the name Spatial Practices that what we're talking about is theories of practice. And theories of practice will insist that you cannot think theory and practice separately. The example is that an acupuncturist who's sticking pins in you isn't first thinking, I have a theory about how the body is healed, and now I'm going to apply that. The thinking and the doing are one and the same action, in just the same way that, you know, acupuncture is not the theoryless sticking in of pins. So when we approach urbanism, approach landscape, and approach the countryside, it's already a story that's in full flow. Mm-hmm. It's a story that's going to go on after us, and we need to build the processes of development that actually say, what is development about? Let's make the best of what's here is what development should mean.
And just briefly, parking, one of the most divisive issues in town planning.
Cars are cool. Oh.
Well, I think zip cars are great.
Say that again?
Zip car is great.
Zip car.
Yeah.
Those carrots, underneath those carrots are cars. So that was good.
Cars are really cool. That's, I mean, they're sleek, they're shiny, they're sexy. You can have sex in them. And there's so much less trouble than getting the horse out and hooking it up to the wagon. However, we have been designing the city to accommodate the car for as long as the car has been around, which is absolutely ass backwards. We really need to think about, because that's, I mean, you take the bulkiest thing, the city, and design it to suit the car. Why on earth aren't we insisting that designers do something better with the car so that it suits the city?
There's a tyranny of geometry associated with transport planning, isn't there? And we've often talked about what makes a beautiful street, what makes a beautiful space, and when it's dimensioned because of to get the road and the vehicle in, you're missing that fundamental about what actually makes spaces beautiful.
I think we should probably move on to the next question, which was, yeah, you've got the microphone?
I wanted to ask about meanwhile space and temporary usage situations. And I guess basically what you thought the role of the environment had, or landscape design and the environment had in that situation, and how much influence it could have, if any, over actually changing or influencing in some way the future development that's destined for that site.
Mm-hmm. How can the temporary use influence the permanent, Anna?
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, I think this is a whole area of study called site activation. Well, I mean, there are plenty of articles written now about meanwhile spaces because they are somewhat seen as the vanguard of gentrification. You know, as a development is prepared, the space is empty for a while, and the first thing developers do is they get lots of pop-ups and markets and all sorts of things that they think will attract energy and activity. And in fact, if you look at Elephant and Castle, you have got exactly one of those pop-up markets in those ship's containers, which have become ubiquitous all around those parts of London, which are particularly like that. And, you know, you'll get street food and all the usual stuff. So I see meanwhile spaces as very having been almost entirely taken over by that sort of thing, which I think is a real shame, because actually meanwhile spaces are also spaces which are in the throes of change and flux, and they're the most exciting, fun parts of the city. I mean, if you think about a bomb site in post-war Britain, that was a meanwhile space, and actually, you know, kids would... I was obviously not there, perhaps I'm being nostalgic. This is what I've read, you know. Kevin Lynch...
And is it true?
I mean, you know, if you read Kevin Lynch on wasteland spaces and spaces on, you know, the sort of unusual spaces that you might stumble across in the city, these are the spaces where people really sort of discover themselves. Or if you look like at a city like Manchester in the 90s, where all the old warehouses got taken over by the music industry, and that was a big motor for gentrification, but it wasn't as clearly planned as it is today. So it's a contested area, and, you know, academics are looking at it carefully, but I think now it has been largely co-opted.
I don't agree.
Yeah, how can temporary use actually resist being co-opted in that way? Which is...
Well, I think you're oversimplifying it knowingly.
meanwhile, spaces still today take so many different forms. And I agree, like the box park, some of them are, you know, significantly funded by the developer, kind of curated by the developer. It's that's one thing. That's the very corporate side of it. And the box park actually in Shoreditch was a reference point that Lendlease used to draw on when referring to the one that's been built at Elephant. And yet the project that I was involved in that's now become Grow Elephant is completely different. Virtually no funding, no input from the developer at all, no marketing, doesn't aid their gentrification at all. It's simply a kind of place for protesters to have got distracted in and let off steam rather than focusing on the long-term damage that's being done to the area.
But will it be soaked away eventually? Do you have a time limit on your... And are you bothered by that? Or actually
well, that's
like...
why I'm not involved, because I am bothered how quickly they were being swept away. And frankly, nothing to do with the developer. The need for a space like that turned out not to be so great. And that's a criticism of the local community or the failure of our project to reach out to enough people to actually make a project on that scale genuinely sustainable. Now, that can be debated. It'd be very interesting. I've been working with students. Some of them are researching it at the moment, whether that's worth it or not. I felt it was worth giving it a go for the opportunity that could come from it, and in the early years it was there. But the disheartening process of moving on earlier than you've been told by the developer kind of kills the will slightly. We hoped in Project One to work with Gillespie's. That was a location that the legacy would be a community garden on the map. A road, largely, but also a bit of community garden. And despite going to many consultations and sharing what we were doing and seeing how some of what we were planting in the meanwhile space could be embraced by that permanent garden, Lendlease and Gillespie's were totally uninterested. And the whole lot's been swept away. Completely pointless.
Can we hear a brief defence from Gillespie's?
Your minions, I'm sure.
Oh, my minions.
please. There are other types of meanwhile uses, too. Like the kinds of things that Wayward is doing with the urban physic garden and things like that. These are meanwhile uses that are programmed to last only a season. And they have a kind of didactic intent. They're in and they're out, and there's no risk of this long-term involvement, which is what happened at the Eastern Curve, which is one of my favorite London spaces, I have to say. It just, you know, it needs to be preserved because it's so glorious.
Well, I think that's the opportunity of having a temporary space or whatever, and a temporary proposition allows time for a new idea, time to evolve some different thinking, different uses, to build the neighbourhood's knowledge in what is possible. Mm. And that's what Grow, Cook, Eat do with an amazing programme. And that was evolved through the process of design, but it was also leaving the proposition open enough for Mary and Brian to come in and have their part to play in it, rather than it but all being complete. And I think that's an important thing, that sometimes, or a lot of times, having unfinished work, in a sense, offers an opening for others to be involved.
I'm seeing lots of hands, so we should move on. Next one there, and there was one there, and then there. She was before.
Hi, I'm Bridget Snaith from the University of East London. I had a question sort of for Richard to start, and then just for the panel in general. I think the question to you was, had the gardening project in Elephant been organised, would you have joined it, or did you start it because you just could? So it's a kind of a question about, would a top-down community garden have made you enthusiastic? And I guess more widely, how could local authorities galvanize that sort of neighborhood spirit at a scale that might operate at a size of a park rather than just, a, you know, like your own street where you immediately are, because we're obviously in a crisis in local government. One of the reasons that the bids came about was because local businesses thought that the tax was too distant and not being spent where they were on the things that they wanted. So how could local government actually engage with that sort of thinking and that kind of localism?
Great question. Okay, Richard, do you want to go first?
So when you say the project, I'm not precisely sure which you're referring to, but I'll choose guerrilla gardening, which was where I started. That was just one flower bed immediately outside the front door to my tower block that wasn't being looked after. The tenant management organisation that had been running the building had been shut down for financial embezzlement. There was no resident association. There was no kind of local structure at all that I could go to. So I became a guerrilla gardener out of practical necessity. The only legitimate way would have been to go to the housing department that looks after the entire borough of Southwark and say, can I look after this small flower bed? And I thought, this is pointless. This is so irrelevant and tiny, I might as well just carry on and do it. But from that success, the pleasure that it gave me, the fun I was having, the interest I got from other people, meant that I gradually took on more and more, and initially overextended myself and did areas that were not within my very geographic vicinity. But I learnt that pretty quickly. So I have got involved in projects like guerrilla gardening in the Haygate. That was something that people said, oh, you know, this is going on. Do you want to join in? On an estate in the south of Elephant and Castle, at the Draper, Greening Draper residence set up, and invited me to join in too. So it can be, I mean, it's not so much top-down, but it's someone else locally doing something. Can be really inspiring. It's a great mix. I've got all sorts of different things I'm involved in. But I think a good model that is more top-down in the traditional sense, as in local authority, is Lambeth Council. I hope it's still going, but I was quite close to a project they called Fresh View, where they facilitate local residents gardening in the street in tree pits by cutting through red tape, checking out the location that the resident might have in mind, but then providing sort of materials to make that happen. And I think Camden Council, maybe Islington too, have guidance online to residents to be able to do that. And I think that's much more sustainable and more exciting than a local authority saying, we need this park to be taken on by residents. Those are landscapes that public money needs to be spent on and professionals need to be involved, even if they're not doing all of it. But I think there's so much potential in what, you know, gardening in the community rather than in a community garden, which will also be providing perhaps a wider benefit as well, be seen by more people as they go about. It doesn't become a destination then, it's a thoroughfare.
I think the participation element is really critical, and Corporation of London do that as well, say on Barbican, they provide some of the tools, some of the expertise, this kind of structure, and then the groups turn up and do it. And that's really great, because it makes that fan street work.
Mm. Okay, the next question was here. Yeah.
Yes, hello. So it's maybe a bit of a basic question, but you've been talking about nature a lot. And I mean, as an architecture student in year one, I'm actually wondering, is landscape only about nature and towns, or is it about a bigger thing that is actually also interesting?
Is landscape also a bigger thing?
Landscape beyond nature. I think the Louis Kahn example is quite a good...
Well, yes, landscape is... We're designing external spaces, we're influencing. Everything we've talked about tonight is about manipulation of space. We're talking about not leaving anything to do its own thing. What my colleague here is doing is very sort of hands-on. It's working very intensely with what's there. I'm looking at bigger parks, say, but in each of these instances, we're working with space. So landscape is about our manipulation of space and our balance. What we hope to achieve is balance with not only what we're trying to achieve, to get out of it, and with our urban spaces, we're talking about density of people, we're talking about interaction, we're talking about a happy city, a happy careful environment, but we're also talking about...
Yes,
but... Aren't we too scared of hard landscaping these days? If Louis Kahn proposed the Salk Institute now, you can imagine the planets would say, where's the greenery? Where's your little pocket park? Why aren't we seeing more...
We shouldn't be afraid at all of hard landscaping, because there are some places where it's really crucial. The fact that Leicester Square was redesigned and not given over to completely hard landscaping is just bonkers. Mm-hmm. It should be just a level plane where actors can display themselves and where stuff can happen. It's so stupid.
There's a scourge of greenery.
The lawn there sort of twice
trees
a week.
Are right. Trees.
The trees are fine. Trees are fine. But the crucial point is that landscape is a building. Landscape is built. It's not just built by landscape architects, it's built by lots of people who have an engagement with it. It's just like cooking, you know, everybody cooks, everybody engages with the landscape, but there are some people who are professional cooks. There are some people who are professional landscape architects, so there's just this kind of gradation. And one of the reasons why it's so difficult to think landscape is because it's so ubiquitous. That we all engage with it. We all do it. So what the heck does a landscape architect do?
Does guerrilla gardening always involve plants, or do you sometimes smash up concrete and just put bits of hard landscape there?
It's a good question. I am obviously very plant orientated, and I'm a gardener, not a landscaper. However, I have put. There was a roundabout, St George's Circus. It's also my garden's lost. That's another one gone to road widening. I had a problem with pedestrians wandering through this flower bed, and because it was a desire line, the flower bed was in the wrong place, they would walk across it and then straight into three lanes of fast traffic to get to the student halls. And I was so fed up of trying different approaches of laurel hedging and trying to block them and all that I thought, no. I'm going to put a path in. So I put a layer gravel path directly to the edge of the curve, leading them straight into the road. And I put a little sign up saying, this is the road to nowhere. And the sign I saw within about 2 weeks was in a window of this student block. So I thought they claimed my little joke as treasure. And the pathway stayed there until the hedge got big enough for it to finally serve its purpose. And as I said, the garden's now been swept away to make room for a bus lane. So, yes.
Any more responses, or should we...
No, I think, you've got, of course, there are the most extraordinary civic spaces all around the world. The interrelationship between trees and surfacing and plants can come in a myriad of different recipes, if you like. So it is what underlies all our lives. So it can be represented in any number of ways according to its location. And
sometimes a landscape architect might say, I think what's needed here is a building. sometimes there's just too much useless open space, and maybe a building would help a street edge to come together. So buildings in a sense are just topography, aren't they? And if you need a bit of street edge topography, then get an architect.
Yeah. Well, La Carton of Vassal famously won a competition for a new town square in Bordeaux. Having won the commission, they took another look at the site and said, this square works fine as it is, so our solution is to do nothing. And they were swiftly sacked and another practice hired. So the next question was there. Yeah.
Is this working?
And then...
Is it working? Yeah.
Yeah.
I'm cheating. It's not really a question. We're here from the Dalston Eastern Curve Garden, so I just wanted to pick up on the meanwhile space question and some of what some of the panel said. I'm delighted to hear, Tim, that you love the garden so much.
It's absolutely one of my favourite
Great.
London spaces.
We must talk about it then, because we are coming into a new period of intense threat, shall we say. But I just wanted to share a few things about our experience that kind of relates to some of what's been spoken about tonight. We worked very intensively with Jo Gibbons and her practice for 2 years. So when we're talking about grassroots up, top down, the London Development Authority were involved, Hackney Council were involved, and we, myself and Brian here, come from a community activist background and horticultural activism as well. But so as I mean, Joe's briefly explained the sort of controversy. I won't go into that. But we had a lot of dialogue, and we were very, very lucky to be working with Joe Gibbons' practice because she and they are extremely sensitive to people and places. So we got our Meanwhile space, but from day one, as far as we were concerned, it was never going to be Meanwhile. We were digging our heels in. It was not just to pick up on what Richard was talking about. And again, we know Richard's experiences, we've shared them, but it was not a place of protest. We weren't really that interested in protest. We were just, we're here, we're staying, we're not going away, because the place that we are in Hackney has no public green space and has virtually no private green space either. So we have always said this is a right, it's not a luxury, nothing to do with gentrification. If we're gentrifying as we go, so be it. But this is a space that is intensely needed and intensely used, intensively used by so many different kind of constituents in terms of the people who live in Dalston. So our experience, as I say, in terms of Meanwhile is we've got in there and we were helped through all those different grassroots meets top down. But, you know, what's that expression, possessions 9/10 of the law? It's sort of getting in, showing how it is and how it can be. And we are constantly adapting to change, which many of these kind of spaces that Anna in particular has shown tonight, they can't. They're built, and as Richard said, they're built, and Tim said, they're built, that's it. The carrots, you know, this is the way it's going to be. It can only get worse in a way.
And is it ironically now protected because other developers are using it as a marketing tool? That could ensure its survival.
The garden? We'd like to think so, yeah. We'd like to think so. But also the strength of feeling in our community, will we have to say. So we're pretty confident.
Point on the front row.
Well,
sorry, just wait for the microphone.
Also not a question, but I wanted to just answer what the lady over there asked about communications with various parks and everything. But there are friends groups, which are really, really important. Mm-hmm. And virtually every space, well, not every, but a great number of spaces have friends groups. And they are very influential, and they do, they are part of the local authority communications, and I'm chair of Alexander Road Park Friends, but that, I'm only telling you that just to say that I meet in Camden with the Friends groups, of which there are many parks in Camden, but also in Greater London at City Hall. So I just wouldn't like you to all go away and think that there isn't any sort of communication, because there is, okay.
And the question right at the back.
Hi. I'd like to say thank you for raising so many important things. For example, Joanna, the fundamental nature of landscape and people. You know, we've been wandering around from the African plains for thousands, hundreds of thousands of years. And it's quite interesting that some of the cuts, like in local authorities, have actually resulted in more involvement of the public in working with the landscape, and people like Richard coming forward to civilize and make beautiful, you know, places that are neglected. And I just think that the landscape is such a fascinating career. Making a small plug, if any of you are thinking about landscape, you know, you can be designing children's playgrounds. You can be designing public open space. You can be designing streetscapes. It's a fantastic thing because, as Tim said, the landscape is actually the whole lot. So I'd really like to thank you for raising many of these things. And the politicization, that's a very interesting one. Maggie Thatcher so hated the public authority called the GLC that she actually flogged off County Hall. And not many people know that, you know, it was owned by the people of London. They paid for that building, and she nicked it. And if you go to City Hall now, you could get arrested if you have a demo outside.
Can I ask, do you have a specific question for the panel?
So I'd like to say...
I think there's someone in the front.
Yeah. One thing I'd really like you to zoom in on, light. Light is now being stolen, I think, by high-rise buildings. So I'd really just like you to talk about daylight and the landscape, if possible.
Yeah.
It's a really big issue, and the pencil tower on by Central Park in New York, the shadow play and the effect of that shadow over Central Park is going to be significant in terms of environmental impact. And certainly our work with Muff and Whitechapel, we projected all the proposed developments together, extruded them in three dimension, and then mapped the shadows, and it was quite terrifying. So that we're enabled to sort of catch and steer some of them just to talk about orientation and which side of a square it would be better for a higher building to be. The basics had not been thought about, but also there hadn't been all these proposals hadn't been put together to see what their cumulative impact was going to be. So I think shadowing of and also the other environmental factors of wind and so on, and what it actually feels like to be on the pavement, is a critical part of our vision for London with 270 towers in the planning system or whatever it is.
We also, like to overlight our spaces as well. We like to sort of, they become sort of pieces of drama. And I think some of the more interesting, quieter spaces, that low-level lighting is attractive because it just, the idea of city of shadows, city of light. I find that the atmosphere more interesting when we don't overlight.
There's another problem with that too, and it's an ecological one, is that overlighting has a real detrimental effect on biodiversity. A lot of invertebrates are nocturnal, and it's actually we're lighting our cities more and more and more, making them clean and green and safe, and actually the green part is being sacrificed there. I just saw Matthew Gandy talking about his recent work, and he's looking at LEDs, which were, everyone thinks, oh great, well they don't use much electricity, but they use lots of rare earths in their manufacture. So we're not thinking this one through all the way.
I think we've got time for two more questions. There's one here.
Do you mind if it's not a question?
Okay, as long as it's briefish.
Well, it's a proposal for a kind of legislation which I think you will represent. I really have to thank you. It's absolutely brilliant. But in your humour about CGI, one wonders, who are those people? And you use this word, meanwhile. We're all meanwhile people. Those CGI people are supreme. They are the meanwhileists supreme. And I think there should be legislation for not representing people who, in one sense, can't exist. If you walk out here, this whole area will be populated by incredibly good-looking young Asian women. Yes. There are some posters, which you must see. And I think this is a sort of delusionary space which, if you're grown up, you can perhaps resist. But I've no idea what it would be like to be young. So I'd like, there's 300 people missing tonight, so they could all be CGI people. And you can choose what they should be like. And I am being quite serious because this connects to language. And I think that a lot of the words you use are brilliant. And I think we should remember that once upon a time there were things called nurseries, and they became garden centres. It took about 20 years for that to happen. The word developer is a lovely word. So why shouldn't we ask developers to inhabit that loveliness?
As a teacher, I'm a developer.
You are a developer. Most certainly you're a developer. And you're an educator. And my last point, that means going out, leading out, by the way. It's from Latin. My last point is that we were children, and if you don't plant a, mustard and cress on the windowsill as a child, everything we're talking about is sort of pointless, really. It's very, I think the sort of undertow to what you're talking about is incredibly babyish. And I mean that as a high compliment, and I thank you for offering tonight.
Thank you, Richard.
I just wanted to come back really quickly on the places that don't exist and the people that don't exist, because actually I think increasingly in virtual reality landscapes, those landscapes are very important for more and more young people today. And these are the landscapes that developers are creating. They're the landscapes that investors can interact with and can change. They may never be built, but actually they are reflected completely in gaming and in the virtual reality world. I haven't really established my what I think about any of this, but I think it's an aspect of the conversation that we haven't touched on.
It was interesting, the Battersea Power Station hoardings, it's only white people portrayed, and I phoned up to the person that had done the marketing, and they said, well, it's what Asian investors like to see when they're buying a flat in London. So that's the reason you think about where these developments are being sold. That's what configures the nature of the image. So they're presenting this amazing kind of whitewashed scene of London back to multicultural London. So you wait for the microphone.
I'm interested in landscape and identity, and to your point, just thinking about top down and the bottom up. To use an example, Todd Morden, which is a town in Yorkshire, Lancashire, which was only famous for Harold Shipman killing his patients, but is now more famous for incredible edibles and the fact that they took a bottom up approach. And basically now have vegetable tourism, as they describe it, and people come from all over the world to see their vegetables. But looking at that as a small on a small scale to something like the High Line, which is one of the most visited attractions, to even the Garden Bridge, which you could argue maybe was so went through because it was such an icon. I mean, do you think that landscape is more valued when it defines the identity of a place? And how can you, as landscape architects and people interested in landscape, make the most of that? To get people to value it more.
I think quite a lot of it is about language. As Richard said, it's about understanding a place and being able to articulate your feelings. And I think we all need to be generous in the profession about the way the vocabulary that we use so that these conversations don't seem exclusive to a certain set group of people, because I think even however much children are and adults are living in a virtual world, there's a kind of real-time world which is at the same time becoming increasingly valued. And whenever we take a youth panel, say the Olympic Park youth panel, and we took them on the Lee navigation, and this group of sort of 11 to 21 year olds had never been onto the canal because they just didn't know it existed, even though they lived in the area. And I started sort of saying, okay, let's just pick a posy, let's just look at the wildflowers and understand this superb piece of engineering. It wasn't like they were going, oh, what's this all about? They were just immediately there. Participated. It literally took 2 hours, and they'd helped us put up the exhibition of drawings that we had at the end. They all got it. They all loved the canal. They all wanted to participate and continue to do so through this process. So it's not like all is lost. It's not like it's these things. We have a deep innate connection with our environment. And I'm optimistic that these things can be mutually beneficial, and that contact and that knowledge can and engagement in the landscape can flourish if we're generous enough to help people understand what it's about, and that needs to be plugged in the education system as well as in the home and in the kind of growing up.
Can landscape also bring character and identity where none exist? I mean, so the Sky Garden, for example, you were looking for the local flora and fauna of the banking world, or you know, what was the locale that you kind of had in your mind when you were conjuring that space?
I think that space was so driven by what would actually flourish in it. I mean, the original proposals had orchards, it had forests, that sort of thing. But when we started to analyze what is, as rightly said, an interior space, it actually almost, in terms of its character, or its planting character, kind of designed itself because of the light levels, because of the enormous temperature fluctuations up there. Mm. And what we had to do was to, if we were going to have any sort of credibility out of the Sky Garden, is to do something that had was successful. And we worked with people at Kew, we worked with the engineers. It was a very complex proposition. So, you know, and that led on to the tree ferns, that led on to sort of all the different sort of plant associations you see in that, because they actually do very well in those conditions. So, and out of that, when you start to look at that, you start to see narratives in that, you start to see stories, and you start to think, yes, this is, you know, when you, you know, there's a flourishing of planting, there's a flourishing of an idea in there. I just wanted to touch on what you mentioned as well. I think our relationship with landscape hasn't really fundamentally changed for millennia. These are spaces for us as people. Our homes are private, our buildings have doors, there's a threshold, a very clear threshold. Landscape is a communal space. And often when I'm working on designs, I think back to the landscapes that were most potent to me, and they're childhood landscapes. I was brought up near marshland, and I always sort of make a very strong association with that hinterland, the idea of flux and flow, and that comes out in my work. But I also are fascinated by spaces within communities where there's storytelling. You know, the idea of the trees, the seats that are quiet, the tree in the shade or in the sun. When you look at, you know, these wonderful images that we often do when we're promoting landscape of Mediterranean life, they're very basic conditions for interaction. And I think what we often do is kind of overanalyze landscape, overanalyze streets, overanalyze spaces. You get a few fundamentals right, as Joe said, shadow, microclimate, wind, you know, you deal with those. You deal with what the actual edge of that space is doing, you know, the interaction with its shops or if it's private spaces. And those provide immense clues as to what would make a meaningful space. And I think that, when I think about what, you know, what the spaces that I've enjoyed the most, there's a paucity to the components of that. But what was wonderful was what was happening in there. It was a place where I met somebody, it was a friend or a lover, it was where my family were, or whatever, and it was associated with a particular tree, it was associated with a particular sort of seasonality. We haven't spoken about seasons tonight, and I think that's something, again, the power of landscape connecting us with cycles. More and more so, I think, than ever before in our cities, which are an absolute culmination of human achievement. We crave that sort of connection with cycles, and when we start to lose that, we start to sit inside. We start to, as one of the audience said, the overlit space. You don't know what's night. You don't know what's day. And I think, you know, the most successful landscapes sort of reconnect us with the very, very fundamentals of our existence. Mm.
Tim?
A lot of our identity is formed from landscapes that are essentially collective. You know, if you're from the South Downs, you know, whose landscape is that? And there's actually a lot of really important work being done right now in and around the issue of the right to landscape, oftentimes under the banner of the European Landscape Convention, which is basically saying that everyday landscapes are places of everyday belonging. There's also an organization in Norway called the Center for Landscape Democracy, saying that the way that we inhabit landscapes is fundamentally part of our democratic constitution as peoples. So there's a lot of really great work that's happening in that realm. And then landscape is always about belonging. whether it's the most mundane landscapes or the most vaunted, and we might need an educated taste, to, you know, a little bit of reading up or working out to be able to appreciate a space like the Sky Garden. You know, it's aspirational space. It's a representation of a certain set of social aspirations within a certain set. So.
Yeah, I mean, picking up on what you were just saying, I think also for me, at any rate, a really successful landscape is about the people in it and the vibrancy of the interactions. And that is also down to the diversity and the mixing together of strangers in a space. And we haven't talked about that aspect. Mm-hmm. I mean, I've talked a lot about the privatization of spaces, but one aspect of that is that you get quite a monocultural type of person that goes to these spaces, and it's actually the diversity of very different people in the city which creates the sort of London that we're very used to, where, you know, we're used to people from all income levels, all backgrounds, all ethnic backgrounds, just mixing in a big melting pot. And I think we're in danger of moving away from that in London today. So yeah, it's about the people within the landscape.
Perfect note, I think, to say it's time to move the discussion to the vibrant, diverse landscape of the bar, and to thank our wonderful panel, but also to thank Central St Martins and Mel and Andreas for hosting this series. So thank you all for coming.